Еще раз всем добрый вечер. Это большое счастье для нас, потому что мы с Дашей и с Варварой Мельниковой, директором сделки, начали говорить об этом проекте «Не бойся этого слова» в прошлом году. В феврале мы взялись за дело, в мае мы снова взялись за дело, но все время, как мы все здесь с вами вместе. И это важная история, потому что иногда важно встречаться и разговаривать. И так академическая манера, которая часто происходит, не позволяет вещам быть понятыми, не позволяет им быть иногда осмысленными даже. Поэтому мы сегодня решили с вами говорить на простом и понятном человеческом языке, оперируя простыми символами и говоря об очень важных вещах, о том, куда движемся, куда мы стремимся, куда торопится этот город, обязательно этот, а любой город, город, как понятие, и куда его двигают три феномена, которые в этом городе существуют. Это музей, это перформанс и человек. Перформанс здесь, кажется, возможно, лишним, потому что я занимаюсь перформансом, и для меня это самая интересная штука. Завтра мы будем говорить именно о перформансе. Вам 6 часов вечером при участии большого количества прекрасных экспертов, спикеров, людей, которые with a lot of different speakers. Ну а сегодня наша тема жутко интересная и очень важная, потому что мы говорим о музее. Сегодня все музеи открыты для бесплатного посещения, в том числе, и я знаю, Ольга Львовна, особенно трепетно относится к бесплатному посещению своего музея, к чему нас довольно часто, я тоже работаю директором, ну, в отличие от Ольги Львовны. Things is especially important to make museums accessible for visitors. As for Strelka Gallery, we also like to open it up for the visitors to come and see our galleries, our exhibitions for free. But today we're going to speak about more complex issues, about how the museums are organized from the inside as institutions. Museums sometimes slowly, sometimes quickly change the landscape of the environment. They change the city and the people who live in these cities. The day before yesterday, we were discussing it with Olga via the telephone, and she used a very important word, consolation. Museums also work for consolations, I think. Today we are going to have three different panels, but all of them are going to be about different roles that museums have. The first one will be museum as school. Before we start, I would like to present all the speakers. I will start from the left. Here is my beautiful friend from São Paulo, Diana Leighton. She is a program director of one of the most forward-thinking museums in the world. The name of it is MOM.
Директор образовательных программ музея в городе Сан-Пауло.
The educational program director from São Paulo's museum, MOM.
Мы очень хотели пригласить в нашу компанию молодого музейного директора, и у нас
we wanted to invite a young museum director, and we succeeded. We invited Ярослав Алёшин, a great curator and thinker from Вадим Сидур's museum.
Один из самых известных людей в мире современного искусства, не боюсь этого слова, во всем мире. Человек, при которого любая ярмарка современного искусства приятно вздрагивает, а любые директора музеев и кураторы немножко подпочиниваются. Это человек, который на протяжении последних почти 10 лет возглавлял музей Уорхола в Питтсбурге, серьезным образом преобразовав не только
музей, но и город вокруг себя.
Ну а сейчас, уже целый год, он работает старшим вице-президентом country,
and at present he is the vice president of Sotheby. It's Eric Shiner. He came not for the Космоску fair, but for our conference, how museum changes the city, and he's going to tell us how his museum, the Warhol Museum, managed to change Pittsburgh.
И, наконец, мой очень большой друг и соратник, человек, который последние годы развивает московские окраины, по людям, которые там живут, они кажутся центром, но тем, кто, как мы, живет далеко оттуда, все время сложно туда доехать. Но вот как раз разговор пойдет о том, как умудряется Катя Бочавар, руководитель двух выставочных залов, которые оба называются проект GRUND, один находится на Песчаной, а другой находится на улице.
One is on the Pishchana Street, and the other is on Irina Levchenko Street, which are quite distant ones, and very few people know about them. GRUND hosts a lot of wonderful events.
Katya
is going to talk to us in detail about her projects. Katya Bochavar, an architect, an artist, and a curator. When we are talking about museums,
изображение Ольги Львовны Свибловой, которую тут же посмотрела на часы.
Ольга Свиблова.
Ольга Свиблова не нуждается в представлении, и пора бежать на открытие партизанской
которую она удрала на 20 минут. И должна туда
скоро вернуться.
She's also giving a talk at another place.
Ну, наконец, у нас есть, we are very happy to have her here. Или из Москвы. У нас есть очень важные гости, хотя сегодня Перм считается каким-то районом Москвы.
A very important guest from Perm.
That's провинциальный, очень гордый этим,
provincial and a very proud of it town, which is sometimes even winning over Moscow in their cultural program.
Итак, арт-директор музея Перм, музея
we are very happy to welcome here Наила Allahverdieva, the art director of the Museum of Contemporary Art from Perm. So we'll start with Olga Sviblova, who is going to tell us about museum and the way a museum can console us. I think it's a very important role for contemporary museums, especially in our times, dark times, when we don't understand what's going on, and sometimes we can't explain to others who we are and what we are doing. When we are in despair, we always go to museums because their doors are always open. And for example, the Multimedia Art Museum is open till late at night, so you can go there after work even. Museums actually turn us into different people in a way. Multimedia Art Museum is located in the so-called Golden Mile in a very posh neighborhood. This museum doesn't work only with the local community. They work with all the residents of Moscow. So, Olga, please welcome. First of all, thank you very much for coming. It's at least quiet here. I've been running all around Moscow, everywhere. First of all, I didn't manage to get to the concert, which was dedicated to the 800th year anniversary of Moscow. Then I was running around the park in the city center of Moscow. It was very loud in the whole city center.
Вступая в зону минус 6-10 градусов, я говорю, но если летом люди пойдут, я шла с ангиной.
I also visited one of the freshly opened caves near the Kremlin. It was freezing out there. And I realized that most of all in my life, what I'm afraid of are crowds.
Золотой. Я понимаю, что приехала издалека.
So, if I walk around the city center of Moscow and see great crowds, this is what I understand is like what I'm afraid of as a child.
There,
I understand that as for the freshly reconstructed city center in Moscow, I understand that a lot of talented people worked on it. If we return to museums,
I think that every one of you has visited museums at least once in your life.
We always work speaking about dystopias. I think dystopias are great when they are totally weird. And we discussed it with Илья Кабаков. We realized that you can't put a utopia or a dystopia into life, but trying to put this vision into reality leads to something like the Great October Revolution. I just gave a talk yesterday about it. I actually hate revolution, but it gave birth to a lot of artists who were part of the great Russian avant-garde and who changed actually the consciousness of the people all over the world. I don't know if you visited our exhibition, which we organized a year ago. It was devoted to the revolution. You can see the the pictures from it on the backdrop, on the screen. When I was looking at some of the pictures, I've realized that they give birth to great ideas. For example, I was looking at one of the aircrafts planned as a kind of a magic object by one of the artists, and I realized that it reminds of the Sydney airport that has been built right now. It totally looks like what was painted by Родченко in 1918. And if you read diaries by Родченко, for example, about the revolutionary avant-garde, you won't find anything about politics. Well, of course, Eisenstein has something in his works about it.
Но в конце 17-го года выстрелы в Петрограде звучали регулярно, поэтому он, в общем, как-то не обратил большого внимания на это.
Discharges, the fire going off. In the diary of Eisenstein, you can read that he was very surprised that the revolution actually came to reality in 1917, because in 1917, as a war was going on, you could hear fires everywhere. He didn't even pay attention to the fossils at the end of the 1970s.
Еще Ленин и Сталин, да, вот на лавочке. Такая фоторетушек, которую мы все воспринимали как реальность.
There are lots of documents from the revolution that inspired me that I used in my work in some of my exhibitions. For example, once in Paris I was reading about
еде,
and I saw references to the Russian avant-garde there too. I was surprised to find some of the photos from the Soviet past in the Paris archives too. Once I found there a photo with Stalin and Lenin, which I was very surprised to see. Like, I've never seen anything, although I researched their images and pictures for a lot of time, but then I realized that it was a photo made very late on into their life.
Невероятный импульс, который нам нужен.
And actually, Stalin and Lenin and the great Soviet revolution is part of our mythology. Some time that was fruitful for the history of contemporary art all over. Last autumn, we hosted an exhibition and titled it with the words from Родченко's diary called Experiments for the Future. But once you come to think about the background in which this artistic revolution, these projects were imagined, then you realize that the space we are in now is actually quite comfortable. And for example, this Strelka space is very comfortable to come and to think and discuss issues, much more comfortable than what than the background in which the great artists of 1917 lived. Fyodor is asking, could you please come back to museums? What I'm driving at is that Fyodor is always creating myths. And we can't live without myths,
but
we can't believe in this myth, like in the picture where Stalin and Lenin are sitting side by side, which was evidently photoshopped. Museums do not change cities for the better.
Я познакомилась с Фостером, это было много лет
when
назад, почти
first
20
met Foster,
лет назад, я прекрасно
знала
20
years ago, I knew perfectly well
его музей, который он создал
his museum that he created in Nîmes,
замечательный, потрясающий, красивый музей
современного
искусства, в котором он идеально вписался в потрясающий, красивый, южный
became a beautiful
французский
part
город,
of this southern French city.
Базилика, и вот so какая-то вот
it was very close to an antique architectural building. It was a beautiful architectural rhyme, you know, between this contemporary architecture and the ancient one.
Лестница, Nîmes.
The main part of this museum is a staircase made of glass. It totally produced the impression that you're walking on water.
This museum is not a great place for work because it has a huge atrium inside and a lot of light in it. Of course, it's beautiful from the perspective of architecture, but for a curator, it's an actually very difficult place to work with. The more functional, the better, I would say. So, Foster gave a talk, and I think Fyodor attended it. Yes, you were there. He also gave a talk in the framework of this program. So Foster said, you know, we built this museum and the city changed. No, the city did not change. I lived in Nîmes. Or at least I visited it 7 or 10 times a year because my husband used to have a house there. It was very close to Nîmes. We came to, so we had our summer house close to it. I think that nothing changed. Museum was always empty. Of course, it had great exhibitions, sometimes bad exhibitions. I was crying and I thought, how is it even possible? Such a beautiful museum, and Foster even believes that this museum changed the city. No, it didn't, because to change the city, you need something totally different. I don't believe that a museum can change the city. I visited Bilbao before Guggenheim Museum opened there. Of course, you know this very famous museum and the famous exhibit by Kunz shown there. Many years ago, I visited Bilbao for Christmas, and I went there to see Kabakov's exhibition, and I thought it was great that the Soviet artists found their way to the West after Perestroika, when the art became commercialized here, let's say, hi to Sotheby's and to other commercialized way of the turnover of art objects.
So, after
the Soviet artists became part of the Western world, they became actually loners, not more a family. They found their way to different museums. When I came to visit this exhibition in Bilbao, I thought it was just horrible because there was nothing around the museum where the exhibition was hosted. We fled from Bilbao to some village nearby. The city was just horrible. Then I came to a totally different Bilbao a few years later, with the Museum of Guggenheim already, where everything was renovated. The city was a masterpiece. I really, really recommend you to go there. Do you think it happened because of Guggenheim? No, it's because the Basque country wants to separate from Spain, and the European Council gave them a lot of money, a lot of finance. So I won't be able to shoot a horror movie there anymore. It's a beautiful city now, which still wants to separate from the rest of Spain. I just don't believe that culture can change our life instantly. Museums work for the people who are loners, I think, not to the collectives. For the people who do not go to parades, military parades, you know, like the ones in the Red Square, although they inspired such artists as Rodchenko and others, for example.
вот это ощущение, вот как на стадионах, но всем известно, что футбол лучше смотреть по телевизору сегодня, потому что ты видишь такие детали, ты
видишь выражение лиц, ты видишь, что не нравится. The way it works with football, for example, everybody knows that it's better to watch football on TV, because you can see all the close-ups, you can see all the muscles working, but still sometimes it's nice to go to the stadiums, because, like, you know, the common wave can bring you up, can influence you. I think that museum, unlike a football stadium, is the space for silence. You know, we welcome all types of visitors, even kids, even people with dogs.
Все знают, как к какому ребенку подойти, что какого создатика предложить ребенку.
Our staff knows how to deal with all kinds of kids, of 3 years old, of 5 years old. For us, our museum is the space for life. But it's also a space for spatial experience, you know. I think space is very important for museums.
Even
from one and the same works, you can make totally different exhibitions in totally different spaces. And I think museums can also give this experience to our visitors when they come and they are one-to-one with the work of. Of course, some people prefer guided tours. Even I prefer to organize guided tours too.
Я всегда узнаю что-то новое для себя.
You know, because when I I also sometimes go to listen to guided tours in our museum, because every time I listen to a tour, I find out something new about the museum I work in. But I think it's not the main thing about museums. I think the main experience is when you are one-to-one to an art object. Because museum is a space for auto dialogue. After Marcel Duchamp, we know that an art object is symbolic. You know, the fountain or the pissoir turned into art just because it was exhibited in a museum. And looking at this Duchamp's piece, we find a lot of meanings, but we find them in ourselves only. We cannot judge art. Art cannot be judged. It's just a symbolic object. We put meanings into it. Thanks to art, the mirror of ourselves, we can have a look at ourselves and see not just the way we look like, do we have good makeup and good hair? No, we can. It's a mirror that reflects something deeper. It's something that we normally do not face, you know? And I think that this auto dialogue is something that gives us energy and makes us stronger, because a work of art requires from us an honest dialogue with ourselves and with the environment around us, because good art always reacts to life. So please come to museums. Reality won't change, and you know, the less revolutionary we are and the less we want to change reality, the better, I think. But if we talk to ourselves a little bit, maybe we'll benefit from it. Thank you very much.
У вас есть возможность задать, у нас есть 5 минут после каждой речи ваших вопросов. Если у вас есть уже вопрос, пожалуйста, поднимите руки.
And in case you have any questions, you are welcome. Please raise your hands.
Мы тем временем готовимся к следующему. Следующей части нашего разговора.
The next speaker will be Naila.
Вопросы, пожалуйста, тяните руки, и мы
so, if you have questions, please raise your hands. Questions to Olga Sviblova. The subject of her talk was museum as school. She said that museum doesn't make the city any better. She was talking about the internal dialect that happens in the museum. So here is your chance to ask a question to Olga. Thank you very much. My name is Daria, and here is my question. Museum is not only about exhibition, it's also about some cultural events. Do you think that this atmosphere of new cultural events and these new opportunities of
you know, which we see through the events, don't all these things change the city? I think they, you know, these cultural events, they do not change the city, they change people. But city consists of people. We have a huge cultural program. We have mom music, mom literature, mom discussion, mom contemporary music. So just like any other museum, we have lots and lots of events. A museum is a space for life, you know? Almost every day we host an event. And when people come to listen to smart people, I always say, it doesn't matter what the speaker says. What matters is that the speaker is wise. And what matters is that we get closer to these people who are bigger than ourselves, in a way. I always say that if time comes for me to leave this life, you know, I will say thank you very much, life, because I managed to meet so many wonderful people, people who are greater than me. Because I think that this, you know, conversations, these meetings are like recharge stations for us. And artists and curators are always great people, big people. I think this feeling of the person's scale is what is important, and we can get this feeling through public talks and through exhibitions equally. I think it's what matters. For example, on the 15th of September, we are launching Brancusi exhibition. Brancusi is one of the most famous and one of the most expensive sculptors all over the world. And, you know, when I speak about price, on the one hand, I feel shy, and on the other hand, I feel like without price, there is nothing to talk about. Brancusi is known as a sculptor, but, you know, he was also a photographer. He made over 5,000 photos. He also filmed a great movie, which he never showed to anyone. And I got curious, why did he never show these things? So, in our exhibitions through Brancusi, we are researching these questions, because Brancusi, I think, was what we call now a multimedia artist. He was using different media for, I would say, his performances. Fyodor is a performance artist, and I would say that Brancusi was also a performance artist. I used to work on this exhibition for a year. I was working together with the director of Pompidou Museum, and we were working in the archives. You know, it actually used to be the studio of Brancusi. Their works are shown here just the way they used to be arranged during his life.
Специальные моторы, на которых крутились все его скульптуры.
So he really did lots of work, which I would call an installation or even a performance, because of all of his works were moving, and they were, you know, this studio of his, which exists now in the Pompidou Museum, I would say is a kind of a performance space, because it never changes, the exhibits never change there, and the arrangement, like the arrangement of works, is permanent. So, what I wanted to say is, when you work on a new project, you are always researching some new topics, and your goal is to engage the visitors into this research. I really love our public; it's very young and beautiful, just like yours, just like you. Because, you know, in some of the museums, when you come in, you see that the people are dull or they're not really interested. But as for our museum, we are very lucky to have great audience.
Не зажмуриваясь, ответили между 30-ми и 60-ми годами.
You know, but I also feel that the legacy of the revolution is getting farther and farther from us. Like, last year I used to ask the graduates of the Moscow State Museum, when did Lenin die? And they say, in between the 30s and the 60s. And it's not a joke, you know? It's really the fact that we are losing our history, and every exhibition has some historical or cultural message behind it. And this message changes depending on the contemporary situation. For example, now when Kirill Serebrennikov is accused of robbery, it also changes something in the context we live in. And, you know, the life, our life is in our hands only, and it's in our power to change life, not in the power of the museums. Joy, anxiety is the environment in which the museum lives, but once visitors come, what matters is our dialogue with them. Because, and, you know, it's very important to understand what people live by, what they know, because I know what people of my generation learned in school, but I don't know what the contemporary school teaches. I also think that the museum has to speak about science and medicine, because if there is no science, then there is, no ground for art, I would say. Without science, museum becomes just entertainment. It's useless, and I hate useless things. I just can't deal with useless things. Our museum was built 7 years ago, and it's open for disabled visitors too. And I always follow the needs of these new types of visitors we work with, different types of people. But, for example, I can't work with deaf and blind people because I can't understand their needs, you know, I can't understand what education they get. I think the main help you can, the main way in which you can help the society is to teach people at school, you know, in the universities. Because I think it's horrible when people die say that Lenin died in between the 30s and the 60s, just because the whole, you know, history of their country is just one bulk of information for them. They don't even differentiate between different decades. Thank you very much, Olga.
Okay,
so we are continuing the topic, a museum as school. Although Olga is my favorite teacher. Olga is leaving us.
Оставила свои брускеты, забыла. Аплодисменты. Вот. И у нас есть с вами довольно важный пункт разговора, который как раз в отличие от очень...
We are going to discuss an important thing to you now.
Рассуждение издалека Ольги Львовны.
Which is more, which I think is closer to our everyday life. Naila Allahverdieva is responsible for the Contemporary Art Museum as PERMM in a provincial town. So she is going to tell us the way that her museum educates the local community, the people who are maybe not ready for this kind of art.
Ваш аплодисмент Наиле Аллахвердиевой, директор музея PERMM.
Please welcome Наиля Аллахвердиева.
Да, добрый день.
You have 15 minutes.
Конечно, переключиться с такого очень образного.
It's very hard, you know, to switch from such a bright talk that Olga gave. First of all, I wanted to say that our museum has a great educational role in our city, and I would say that every museum is a kind of an educational machine, because it, you know, it translates images, it gives out images, even if you host exhibitions only, still you educate the city.
как попадает аудитория в музей, да, и как бы и насколько глубоко.
Of course, the question is what visitors come to our museum and how deeply they understand what's going on.
Есть как бы конкретная история жизни Пермского музея современного искусства. Это очень молодой музей, был создан 8 лет назад.
Contemporary Art Museum is very young. It was created a few years ago in the framework of the project PERMM as a cultural capital of Russia, and it was one of the most ambitious projects in PERMM. And just try to imagine that in our provincial town of Perm, a very industrial town, what appears is a huge museum of contemporary art in the former river station. It turned into a kind of a plant that started producing lots of exhibitions of international level. But the problem was that the local community was not ready at all for these exhibitions. For us, it was the main challenge. So, at the beginning, after the very birth of this museum, we launched a program called Museum in the City, and I think it was the most ambitious public art program in our country, which was really ambitious. It was focused on integrating, on introducing contemporary art to the local audience, on creating bridges that would connect the local audience and contemporary art. So we wanted to bring the audience back to museums.
PERMM cultural project was actually part of a bigger political project, the whole public art program, and many other projects of that time actually became an object of political speculation, unfortunately, and people were not reacting to contemporary art in as so much.
Какие-то помехи идут. Можете попробовать?
Мне кажется. Это салют, ура!
We have fireworks in the city, that's why it's so noisy, sorry. So, what I wanted to say is that people were reacting like to negative image, political images they had in their heads. So, one of the goals of our public art program was to introduce different cultural practices to the city. We wanted to work with different strategies, different materials, different practices to present art in the urban environment. Because we all know that our provincial towns know basically what they know is only the bronze monumental propaganda. What we wanted to do was to change this perception of art as beautiful propaganda only. Our program caused lots of discussions. I think it became the most discussed program of the PERMM Cultural Revolution. The museum and the program was also risking something. It turned out that we had lots of stakeholders, people who were against us. Of course, of course, we had some allies, but also we had some enemies. So, when the political situation changed and we had a new governor who had nothing to do with the cultural revolution that was launched, had been launched a few years before, so with the new government we had to change the whole museum program. We had to stop our public art program, unfortunately.
What mattered for me was overall to educational programs. I wanted to establish a totally new relationship with the local communities. I wanted the local community to see our museum as part of their life. But you know, in 3 years before the government changed, we managed to find lots of allies, and that's what helped us survive the new government. Now, our museum is in a different location. So it used to be in the river station, but now it's been renovated, so we were moved to a shopping mall, actually. I want to tell you about two case studies from our history. Both of these projects, sub-projects I'm going to talk about, were aimed at developing, you know, the public dialogue. The first project is called «Mama, forgive me, I'm going to be an artist». So as you can see, most of our educational programs are focused not on art history, but rather for, you know, creating environment for the artists to appear. So that's actually our goal, to breed new artists. And we think that such an approach led to having more and more allies. One of other projects was called Ageless Museum. In this project, we worked with people who are older than 55 years. I think it's one of the most inspiring audiences because they don't have any preconceptions towards contemporary art, and they're eager to get new knowledge because for them, it's actually a new life. So this project started from Sveta Luchnikova's idea. She was the curator of this project. She realized that she never actually talked to her grandmother and grandfather, so she created this project for aged people. It was aimed at giving new practices and new experience to the aged people. The curators went to clubs along with the aged people. We gave them some lectures on contemporary arts. So we gave them totally different experience through different workshops, going to nightclubs even. So this project gave birth to another one, which was called the Common Courtyard. So what was this project about? There were groups of different participants. For some reasons, they were all women. You know, the projects are open, but for some reason, men never come. So all of our participants are women. All the participants were split into groups, and every group was assigned an artist, from street artists to, you know, conceptual artists. They worked in their own courtyards. So, actually, every group had to design a project for their own house, for their own building. You know that in Russia it's very, like, a widespread tradition to set something up near your house, but normally it looks extremely ugly, and we called it household. We have, like, a name for it, which is household art. But the goal of this project was to turn it into something like more articulate, I would say. So these groups listened to different lectures. They had lots of discussions. This is one of the projects which was created in the framework of these sessions.
Они начали делать трафареты. Он трафаретный
They made stencils.
Они и начали изображать for, себя, интегрировать себя вот в этот граффити, ну двор,
for graffiti.
Этот, ну реальными граффити.
Yeah. Но so, только у них стали they were living in a building with lots of graffiti on it. What these aged ladies did, they introduced themselves into these graffitis. You can see that they started to make stencils of their own portraits. So the residents became the objects of the street arts in this community. They made stencils themselves. You see? Вера Ивановна, she wrote her own name on the wall. So, what is below in green is a real graffiti done by some street artist. What was above it was the name Вера, which one of the participants did. These are pictures of some other works which were created in the framework of our program. Something was made from paper, like small paper birds, which also stayed in the courtyards.
В котором живут люди, вот эти наши участницы, и они решили превратить это в
This is also one of the buildings whose residents participated into in our program. The building is very old, as you can see. What the participants did, they collected the memories of the local residents, of the residents of this house, and they wrote it on the walls. For example, one of the graffiti says, when we started living here, there were benches, but in 1997 they were demolished. The other one said, we actually love our neighbors, we are great friends, we talk every day. You see, these writings is a kind of a memory book which appeared on the walls of the house. On the one hand, it's quite sad. On the other hand, it was covered in different media, and actually some of the parts of these graffiti changed something. For example, on one of the walls it said, you know, our attic is really terrible, it's dirty and very dark. And then like the local authorities came and they cleaned it and they repaired the line T system. So you see, this is how street art changed the actual reality of the house. Of course, these changes were facilitated by artists too. This is another project by Peter Stabrovsky. He was a facilitator of another group. This is one of the landscapes they worked with. What they did, they created a kind of a museum by collecting different objects they found inside. We also have an alternative educational program with teenagers. Настя Шипицына, our other curator, works with them. She has a different strategy. So if aged people require a lot of communication, you know, they want to talk, as for teenagers, they are quite destructive, so they have a lot of anger and negativity, and the goal of this program is to transform this anger into something positive, into the work with the local environment. This project is mostly aimed at reinterpreting the local environment.
Проекты в гардеробе, в каких-нибудь лифтовых зонах и так далее. И, ну, как бы постепенно там та или другая
Very
группа
slowly,
учатся,
ну, как бы,
с одной стороны, деятельному отношению
of
к городу,
teenagers,
с другой стороны, они,
on the one hand, they learn to act, you know, in the urban space.
Скажем, не так. Задача, как бы, реализации своих проектов в городской среде приводит к тому, что они становятся очень любопытными в области современного искусства, например, истории искусства.
As for contemporary art, some of them get interested in the history of art, even.
оно становится как бы очень активным.
So,
они, например,
after taking part in our programs, the teenagers get really engaged in art. Sometimes they come up and they say that our library is too small, they need more books.
So,
thus these teenagers turn into stakeholders, they become our fans.
И вот Вера Ивановна как раз сказала, Господи, ну то есть это очень интересно.
A very short while ago, I gave a tour on the projects which were created by the groups of aged people together with the participants, and one of them, Vera, said that this project really changed her life and changed her perception. If you have any questions, you are welcome. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much, Naila. I'm sure that a lot of people have something to say. Thank you very much. Here is my question. My name is Dasha. How do you work with teenagers exactly? And what is their reaction to contemporary art? Because I think that actually the audience of Museum of Contemporary Art is exactly teenagers before under 18 years of age. Well, I said it very briefly that we have a huge range of different programs. As for teenagers and young people in general, it's the core of our audience, that's true. And we have lots and lots of programs. For example, this year,
территории, в которой проходят такие образовательные практики, мы пытаемся уже становиться таким методическим.
We are trying to become a kind of a center for other museums, you know, where other museums can get inspiration and materials from. For example, Mr. Pinson curated a program called A Teenager Plus Museum. In the framework of this workshop, the teenagers were sitting through the session and they were trying to explain to the museum staff what they needed in a museum, what they wanted to see in the museum. So we're trying to establish these bridges with our audience. When we are trying to get feedback from them, we let them make some projects which are later implemented in our museums. For example, one of the halls in our covered exhibition was designed by teenagers themselves. And the exhibition is devoted to their diaries. Try to imagine that. They were mostly girls, and they exhibited their own diaries. It became a very, I would say, central exhibition. So, in short, we are trying to create this feedback loop to hear teenagers. Actually, you were right that the core of our audience are teenagers and young people, but after we started working with aged people, we realized that our public is much broader. We just haven't found our audience yet. I just wanted to say that the project is fantastic. I think that you can actually sell it in a franchise, and I would be the first person to buy it, because, you know, in Solyanka VPA, we have lots of grandmas coming, and we don't even know how to talk to them, because some of the exhibitions are just not for them. So this program is just gorgeous. This is what we need. So if you write some guidelines and send the guidelines to us, I think we'll be happy to implement all of it, and not only us, but also other museums in Moscow and abroad. I think it's a fantastic project. One more question coming. Thank you very much.
Насколько ли в нынешней ситуации в стране возможно повторение пермской истории?
Is it possible to, you know, to repeat the PERMM cultural revolution in the contemporary political situation? Will your museum survive, you know, with a new governor, with a new mayor? Well, you know, for the past 3 years, I personally am doing kind of crisis management. The museum is desperately trying to survive, basically. We are trying to become part of the local urban community and not to depend so much on the political climate. You know, when a museum becomes a part of the life of the local community, it's not that easy to shut it up. Yeah, so all of the participants of your programs will come to protect you. Yeah, yeah, they're saying it even now that they are ready to protect us. You know, it's great because the audience is protecting you, and our audience is both teenagers and retired people, which is rare.
Я не знаю, понятно, что ситуация вообще в Перми не очень простая.
Well, you know, the situation in PERMM in general is quite complicated. We have a new governor. The climate, the political climate is changing, but I think we'll still survive.
Единая Россия, конечно.
The new governor is, from the United Russia Party, which is the party of the president. So all of our institutions are now in a suspended state, not only us, but also the ballet theater, for example. So our strategy is kind of zen, reacting here and now. And we don't have an opportunity, you know, to see into the future.
Заканчивая блок музей как школа, хочу сказать, что кейсы подобные Наилиным – это фантастическая надежда для музеев Москвы, которые довольно часто являются ленивыми и очень быстро
вращающимися структурами.
И вот, например, для меня лично сейчас
for me personally,
был такой инсайт, потому что
it became a kind of an insight.
Послезавтра, придя на работу,
you know, the day after tomorrow, I will come to work in our gallery and I will try to think of a project for aged women. I think it's very important that they will be women only, because unfortunately retired men are unlikely to come. I think it's a great lesson to us all. Maybe it's also a beam of hope, in a way, because if you in PERMM can do it, then it means in Moscow we can do it even better. It doesn't matter that some people from our community are in jail, unfortunately. So let's proceed to the next section of our talks. I think it's also a very important topic. I will start from my personal experience. About 2 or 3 years ago, we introduced the year of equal opportunities for Moscow. I think it's one of the most tragic projects of the Moscow government, Moscow authorities. What did they do? They just started to pretend that institutions in Moscow started to think about disabled people. The manifest of this was when, a number of builders came without telling us anything. They came and started to break our floor. We asked, sorry, what are you doing? They said, well, you know, we'll set up rails for disabled people. Then, of course, they never succeeded in anything, so we'll just have to repair the mess they did. Then they came later with a contract. They say, sign it. I said, no, I won't do it. They said, okay, then we'll come with bandits. The next day, they came back and they offered me some money. It was around 5 years ago, sorry, my mistake.
Произошел следующий эпизод этой истории. К нам пришли люди с
клеем. People with glue came to us and set up yellow
зал номер два и зал номер три.
You know, yellow braille plates in every hole, which read as braille hole 1, hole 2, hole 3. So I still have these plates in every hole. I just decided to keep them as a monument to our times. And I think it actually shows the way the government treats disabled people with different disabilities.
Но есть и прекрасные случаи.
But there are also some beautiful cases. There are also some academic cases and practical cases. When different foundations attract people with disabilities and welcome them. It's not only the garage museum,
which has a lot of budget.
Olga Sviblova was shouting to me over the phone just 2 days ago that they are just spending crazy money on the exhibitions. It would have been better if they spent it on, you know, people with disabilities, for example. I'm going to pass the microphone to Yaroslav Alyoshin, who is responsible for a small but very important museum, Vadim Sidur's museum. He also served as a curator of different projects, the goal of which was to, you know, to engage people with disabilities. So, Yaroslav. Please welcome. Hello, my name is Yaroslav. I am very happy to see all of you here, and I am very happy that you preferred to stay here instead of watching the fireworks.
Федор просил меня сказать несколько слов о наших инклюзивных программах.
Федор started to ask me to say a couple of words about our inclusive programs. I specifically focus on inclusive programs for my niche, museum, exhibition hall. Still, I think if I just tell you what we do, it will be kind of a success story. But frankly, I don't think that we achieved any considerable success, or at least it can't be called success until the society is transformed and our perception of ourselves and of other people is transformed. We still have what is called barrier culture, barrier environment. So I would say that we are successful only when everybody is truly equal and when the environment is accessible to everyone. So today I'm going to try to answer the question, what kind of people does inclusion mean? You know, inclusive projects are a kind of a household term for all the museums. Everybody likes to use the word inclusion in advertising basically everywhere. First of all, of course, it's on the one hand, it's great. On the other hand, all of these projects, unfortunately, are based on, you know, thinking that people with disabilities are kind of special people who need some special programs or some special art even.
Существенную проблему вот такое как бы восприятие людей с инвалидностью представляет в контексте как бы истории существования музея как институции. Да, в том, что
it's especially painful for museums. In the environment, you know, museums appeared in the Enlightenment era because the colonial European consciousness needed to establish itself, you know, like to define its own history, its own culture. Kunstkameras also served the same goal when people showed basically monsters to define what is right and what is wrong. Which define what is right and what is wrong in our society. So now contemporary culture, because of this history of what I called kunstkameras or the museums where people with different disabilities were shown to public in the 19th century. So actually we inherited this kind of attitude to disabilities, unfortunately. What is postulated now is that disability is something inspiring, but still it's very often objectified, and quite often so-called normal people use disability just to define their normality again, you know, like we include disabled people in our normal museums, and that makes us
more novel.
Этого разрыва, да, была как бы центральной точкой нашей деятельности музея.
And for us, realizing this was the starting point.
Чтобы вы не скучали.
I will play a video.
Так вот, началась она в 2015 году, когда исследуя архивы музея, общаясь с людьми, которые стояли в выставке, возник он фактически в 1987 году, юридически в 1989, то есть довольно давно, почти 30 лет назад.
Legally it was established in 1989.
Еще в этот самый ранний период существования нашего
музея. And you know, looking through the archives, I found out that even in the early years of our museum,
его творчество были организованы несколько визитов и экскурсий.
The curators, the then curators, organized visits to our museum for deaf and blind people. I think this is unique experience for the Soviet times.
Интернаты были разработаны впервые эффективные методики обучения и социализации слепоглухих людей, людей, лишенных одновременно зрения и слуха,
a famous boarding school for deaf, and blind kids, and that was a really breakthrough institution that introduced some special education for their kids. What made breaking news was that four kids from that boarding school in Zagorsk, in a small town, managed to enter Moscow State University, and one of these kids later became a PhD holder in psychology, and you know, this is something unthinkable for the Soviet time and even for our time.
Музей модернистского, как бы формалистского, как тогда говорили, скульптора, были организованы эти визиты. И, судя по всему, во всяком случае, мне
from the archives, we found out
эти визиты были первым
from the early years, our museum was in touch with people with different abilities and different needs.
Вот этот разрыв, этот первый разрыв, да, между как бы всеобщей фасцинацией по поводу того, что мы наконец вот сейчас только-только начали как бы заниматься эксклюзивными программами, да, оказывается, еще 30 лет назад.
What we are facing nowadays is the common fascination of the fact that we are, they say, hosting like the first inclusive project, but like even from the history of our museum, you can see that such attempts were made even 30 years ago, and maybe even before. We just don't know about it.
С одной стороны, а с другой стороны, с контекстом модернистского как бы искусства Вадима Сидура, неофициально.
On the other hand, our museum is hosting like modernist art by Vadim Sidor.
And
what we are facing is the gap between like this audience with special needs and our art,
and
the gap between situation in post-Soviet Russia and like the international attitude to people with special needs. So we thought that this was fruitful ground for multidisciplinary discussion. We organized a program together with Anna Vilchenko and with the VAC Foundation. This is Alexander Suvorov, who later got a PhD in psychology. So, the aim of our program was to launch discussion in the society, not only in Russia, but also, you know, internationally, about disability studies. We invited people from the States, from UK, we invited an independent curator from Australia. We invited somebody from Germany. So our goal was to make a series of panel discussions and to form some common agenda. We were trying to word what is it, disability, and how we can work with this discourse.
Мы организовали экспериментальную выставку. Она не была центральным событием.
We also organized an experimental exhibition, which was not an event in itself. It was just a way for us to launch a dialogue with different visitors.
Вот эта история про пожилых людей, для которых специально были разработаны.
I really liked the case study from the previous speaker, Naila, who spoke about programs designed for aged people. We tried to make a step further and to get rid of this stratification. We tried I think something happened with the video. Please help us with the video.
Представить произведение современного искусства в диапазоне от модернизма до как бы.
So we tried to present contemporary art from modernism to
для выстраивания неких социальных отношений, в которых как бы
постконцептуал практисис. And our goal was to present the participants which would be like on equal, totally equal ground.
Была, например, замечательная
австралийская The participants was Amanda Katya from Australia, who had a motto once, disable the museum.
То есть радикально изменить позицию
radically, she wanted to change radically the position of the viewer, to change the distance from the audience and the museum.
When
I started my talk about speaking about how museum appeared, you know, in the age of enlightenment, when the museum was exhibited as something very beautiful and ancient, and the goal was for the visitor to come and see that he's not like first he inherited all of those things in his culture, but on the other hand. It's not him, he's normal, and they're kind of not. As for our exhibition, we made it accessible to all kinds of visitors. It included sculpture, first of all, with Vadim Sidur. It also included some of the conceptual art, including Yuri Albert. Our exhibition also included some of the video pieces,
Но именно представление о том,
which
что у нас может быть двух разных культурных повесток да, для двух разных типов людей, что у нас есть одна культура,
да, в этой framework of our museum,
которые непосредственно недоступны как бы человеку.
You know, we just can't define people anymore.
Но, тем не менее,
of course, something in this video won't be accessible to people who can't see, but still, these people will get the main idea of the artist, and that's what matters. And there are different ways of adapting, you know, all kinds of works for all kinds of viewers, visitors. For example, as for the video or the film,
посетители мастерской
What exists is commenting
or
audio descriptive commentary,
искусству,
you know,
потом,
which lets of all kinds of visitors to get this experience to understand what the artist wanted to comment.
Sorry, to convey. Казалось бы, сложные пластические решения, да, это я. Сложные пластические решения оказались гораздо более доступны именно благодаря своей
комплексности. Which were also accessible to everyone.
Важен опыт осмысленной трансформации музея.
What was important for us?
Материального пространства.
We wanted to transform the museum.
Которое предполагало не формальное как бы, исследование рекомендаций, надо сказать,
into
что российское законодательство в области обеспечения доступности
you know, as for our legislation,
чрезвычайно прогрессивное. It's very progressive.
If you read like all the requirements to museums, it would appear that Russian museums are front-end. They are accessible to all kinds of visitors.
But
unfortunately, very few things from these papers are implemented just because people don't get
who needs it and why we need it. Понять, для чего нужен каждый
Our goal was to understand
не вставлять никакого труда реализовать при желании. Кстати, хочу заметить, например,
why all of these requirements were necessary and to show that they were necessary.
Различных социальных учреждений составляет в год порядка 300 миллионов. То есть, в принципе, как бы при желании
you know, actually,
подать заявку,
technically,
получить деньги, чтобы реализовать проект
administration gives 300 million to anyone who wants to adapt their facilities, their institutions to people with special needs. The problem is that nobody applies for it because people just think it's not unnecessary.
Я их лично для себя называю следующим образом. Одна логика — это логика объективации.
As for our work, I think there are two different approaches to people with special needs. The first one is objectification, like when people with special needs are objectified.
И есть как бы другая логика. Логика
So basically these like new programs,
which adapt museums.
to visitors with different abilities. They actually used as a kind of marketing tool. What we are fighting for is, on the contrary, subjectification of all the visitors. We want to get rid of all barriers that do not let visitors see us and visit us.
То есть когда мы говорим о том, что такое безбарьерная среда, мы, как правило, предполагаем пандусы, брайлевскую навигацию,
Actually, it's something that can be applied to all of us. When we think like environment without barriers, but we normally think that it's only about pandas and the things done for people with disabilities, but actually, like elevators is also part of this culture of accessibility, and it's also part of getting rid of barriers, you know, because not everybody can walk seven flights, for example, although we do not have any disability as such. So I think that actually it's about just working with the society, working with culture.
There are no normal people, and кстати, по поводу людей с ограниченными возможностями. Один из героев
And
видео,
there were no abnormal people.
Суворов,
Unfortunately, we didn't see both videos which I prepared for today's talk. You know, one of the participants of this video, Mr. Суворов, when he hears the word people with you know, disabilities, says, do you think that your abilities are internal? Well, I will pause here. Does anybody have any questions?
Я тогда скажу одну важную вещь, которая мне пришла в голову. Я буквально позавчера на Фейсбуке, у меня есть подруга Вера Шенгеле.
The day before yesterday, I was on Facebook. I have a friend, Вера Шенгейна.
Мы об этом еще будем подробно говорить завтра, потому что
she
нашу, который сделал фантастический проект этим летом сейчас.
Works with people who have to live in boarding houses because, well, as orphans, they were diagnosed with some psychological, psychotical illnesses, which they actually do not have, but they have to live like the whole life in these boarding houses, and they don't have any way out. We're going to speak about this in detail tomorrow, because Katrin Nenashova is an artist who works a lot with these people, and she's going to be with us tomorrow. So, coming back to the Facebook, Facebook message I saw online, Вера Шенгейна said,
тем, кто однажды произнес слово черножопый, да, или там косой, или там чурки, да, ну то есть такие люди, которые сказали, ты так все, я с тобой не разговариваю больше.
I really respect people who can ban others,
who
can just, you know, get rid of friends who use words like black and other non-politically correct expressions. But then she said, why can't we become people who would stop being too polite,
музеев и других учреждений, где работают наши друзья, в силах которых сделать пандусы на входах.
You know, we have to stop visiting cafes or museums which are not equipped for people with all the needs, with different needs. You know, you don't have to be too particular about the language. What you have to be particular about are the actions. And like, if you can see that the space you are coming to a museum or an institution is not equipped for disabled people, you could just, you know, it could be a personal riot. Do not go there. We're going to come back
to this
later. Does anybody have any questions to Yaroslav? Questions?
Спасибо вам большое
Thank you very much.
За то дело, которое вы несете в массы. Вот как следствие вопрос. А город как-то, город, государство как-то помогает вам
Does the,
менять эту реальность?
Do the authorities help you somehow?
Как-то становилось лучше, продуктивнее, светлее?
Do you get any help from the authorities?
Ну, откровенно говоря,
Frankly,
Мне грех жаловаться, потому что, во-первых, музей Сидора является государственным
музеем. Our museum is a state-owned one.
В музейном выставочном объединении Манеж и.
It's part of the Манеж.
Рекламы просто факт за все то время, что
network of museums.
Проектами со стороны руководства Манежа мы встречались.
And Манеж management helped us a lot.
С городом ли
As for the authorities, the local authorities.
На границе
From our district,
недалеко от
we are very far from the city center in Novogireva.
Кстати, да. Там даже есть сталинские дома, Катя. Так вот, вот сейчас мы в следующие выходные будем проводить
weekend,
по районам Перово и
Новогиреево
инклюзивную экскурсию.
Мы give inclusive guided tours around our district.
Деле, как бы, so these tours
are going to unite together to the different people in researching their neighborhood. So we're going to discuss what their neighborhood looks like. You know, from the point of view of different people. And our authorities all supported us, but never gave us any money. And we never asked them for money. As for the finance, you know, you don't need anything to organize a tour for people with different abilities. You don't need anything, you just have to, you know, look through your archives, the archives of your neighborhood. Then what you have to do is to make a tactile copy of the drafts of the pictures for the people who can't see. You don't need actually a lot of money for that.
Спасибо. И еще один вопрос.
One more question.
Я уже, а ты мне тогда микрофон дашь.
Добрый вечер, меня зовут Дмитрий.
Good evening, my name is Dmitry. Thank you very much. It was very impressive. And I really respect what you do. Maybe it would sound immoral, but from the commercial point of view, like, what's the ground for your relationship with people with different abilities? Like, it's just free for them.
Дело в том, что это как бы норма, которую опять.
I think it's a norm, which is also. Yeah, which is also set up by the authorities. So in all the documents, the authorities tell you officially all the events have to be free for people with different abilities.
Ну, мы предлагаем коммерческий продукт, в смысле значки, например.
We offer some small commercial products for our visitors, for example, badges or some souvenirs, but it's in our like museum shop for them and for everybody else. We don't have any niche products for disabled people or differently abled people, just because we think it would be weird. Thank you.
Но мы двигаемся дальше внутри нашего блока, который называется «Музей как доступная среда».
So we are moving on with museum as accessible environment. The next participant of our tour came from afar. I would call this sofa a jet lag one, because one of the speakers came from Los Angeles, the other from São Paulo, which is 14 years flight to Moscow.
Мы их оставили под конец,
so we kept them to be at the end, you know, of our discussion, so that they could have a nap throughout the talks by previous speakers. Дайна Лейтон is the director of educational programs for the Museum of Modern Art of São Paulo. I think it's an amazing case study, because it's a museum that has to adjust to the local environment. It's located in a park where everybody comes to. I think Dana is going to tell you about that. Every Saturday, 10,000 of teenagers come to that park to take drugs, you know, to have parties, and a museum has to participate in it, has to deal with it somehow. Then the community, the museum community also has people with very different abilities, with very different backgrounds. I think it's one of my favorite museums, Museum of Modern Art of São Paulo. And I'm sure you'll love it. So Diana Layton, Educational Director of the Museum of Modern Art of São Paulo. Please welcome.
Okay, so good evening. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming. Thanks, Fyodor, for inviting me. Thanks, Strelka, for having me. It's a pleasure, a big pleasure to be here and to hear all these amazing experiences. So as Fyodor told, we were in a very complex situation. We are hosted inside the park, the most visited park from São Paulo. And São Paulo is like one of the main cities of the world, so we're talking about a lot of people. And it's a city that we don't have beaches, we don't have like public spaces that are for free. So this park, people from all around the town and the state come to have fun and then to drink a lot of alcohol, drink a lot of, and then you can put like, yeah. So there are some images that we were. So this is our museum, and the youngsters were outside, and we were like, they were just in building a risk situation, and you can see that it's all a mess. You know, the police officers go with these motors, with the cars, like all over the people, and it was a complex situation because they were all very corrupt. The city hall doesn't do much thing, and then we had like 15 to 20 alcoholic comas each Sunday and a lot of fight situations. And then this is just a movie that I did with a pen that's a camera that we were just walking with the camera. And then this was the first thing. So this is an alcoholic coma. And then the second thing was just our team to walk around without doing anything, but just trying to know these youngs, where do they came from, what do they wish for this space, and then we started the program that I'm going to show you today. But before that, I would like to tell a short story that has a lot to do with what Yaroslav was telling here. So we have a 20 years program with people with disability, people with vulnerability, mental health community, and everyone. And what we say is that what it's normally considered a disability, a barrier, an obstacle, we understand as a possibility, as a potentiality. So, and then I will talk more about this tomorrow at 8 p.m. about our work with accessibility. And then we get to this concept that accessibility for us is not only about promoting access to what already exists. Like people, we are the Museum of Modern Art, you can come, you're very welcome. No, it's not only about that. It's about thinking, it's about promoting access to thinking and building the reality we all want to live. So it's about people. So we have like this educator, Paulo Freire. He says, so thinking about this, these questions, does museums change the city? And he say, Paulo Freire says about his, one of our main inspirations, he says, okay, he was saying about education. Education doesn't change the world. Education change people. People change the world. So we started to receive the deaf audience in the museum. And then we just realized that the communication was so long and hard with educators, hearing educators from the museum that couldn't speak sign language, and the interpreter that had no idea about contemporary art, and the kids was just like focusing in trying to communicate. And when we saw a class with a deaf teacher, we just found out like, oh, this is obvious. They must be the educators of the deaf community. And it was just a thing that we started just to receive the other deafs, the friends from the schools. And then what happened is that a lot of cultural spaces, a lot of museums started to hire these educators for them, their team. And nowadays in São Paulo, you can go, even Stevie Wonder, when he'd been there to make a concert, he said he was really like well impressed about accessibility, because like now the deaf community can visit like a lot of museums and be received in their first language, in sign language. So, and it's not about only promoting like access that they can be received in their first language, but also the museum got access to the deaf community and the deaf culture. So we have, like, for instance, we have music shows, they are all with sign dancers, we have like a storytelling, it's a storyteller that's bilingual with sign language and Portuguese. And also, for instance, we have this, and this I'll talk more tomorrow as well, like Sensity, that's a party that we do in the museum. Once a year, we take all the artworks out and we do a multi-sensorial party that you can hear the music, feel the music, taste the music, and smell the music. So we have this vibrating floor that people can feel the music. We have like sign dancers to see the music. We have this aroma jockey that's a DJ that mixes the aromas to translate like feelings that the music brings, and a food sensation all inspired in music. So this is this story tells a bit like what we learn for the community and how clear it made to what could we do with this situation, with this risk situation about the youngs. So we started this program that called Domingo Mang. He was created by the Department of Education of Mang in October 2013, and aims to occupy the museum's surroundings through educative and artistic activities in order to prevent violence, alcohol, and drug abuse amongst the young who visit the park on Sundays. Free and open to everyone, the program developed a work that combines the museum expertise with the demands of his public, responding to the demands from the young population. So those are the youngs. So the program was created in face of this occupation. In thousands, who I already mentioned, have this abusive consumption of alcohol and other drugs and violence. So what did we do? We based it on the following premises, like accept and encourage actions that already occur in the park, like the spontaneous dance and music meetings. For instance, B-Boy, the Break Boys, they started like to be part of our programmation. To elaborate a cultural program in the museum's surroundings with our repertory that we came to outside, and establish a channel of permanent dialogue among young people, understand their demands so we can cooperate with them. We just found out, for instance, that a lot of these youngs was like gays or lesbians or transgenders or transsexuals that was not accepted by their parents or families and had a huge problem, and sometimes just come Sunday just to relax and chill. And then we do a lot of dialogues about human rights, about the LGBT rights, and how can they stand by themselves like for their rights. So in 1 year of program, like now the program have 3 years, the public participation increased gradually, and the incidents involving the youngster decreased significantly, and the museum has become close to the young. So this is... And then Domingo-ma, it's subdivided into six axes that are transversally. That the first is music. So by the morning when the youngs are arriving, like on Sunday, so they hang out Saturday and they are hangover. And on Sunday morning, we just do an art workshop of fine arts activities together with the families that goes to enjoy the park. And in the afternoon, we do something like big for crowds. And then this is the axis music. So one space for presentation and workshops of instruments highlighting the diversity that exists in the place. The second axis body. These are a group of Beyoncé fans that they do like this huge flash mobs all over the city, and today they are the one who proposed workshops in Domingo-ma. The presentation and the open workshops are related to dance, body awareness, health, and well-being. The proposals promote experiences that contribute to a body integration and sensitivity. Street culture. That we stimulate the occupation of the space under the marquise. We have this big marquise in the park, and it was all related of hip-hop, skating, and rap battles, and through them we raise awareness of the identity and the story of the city. And popular culture, like the Brazil, it's one of the main, like, diverse culture, because of we have the Native American Indians, we have like all the slaveness that come from Africa, and we have like all the other immigrations and a lot of popular culture, and sometimes these youngsters are only like seeing the mainstream things, so we bring these workshops so they can know a bit better about their own country. So like Kakuriá, Jongo, and this popular manifestations such as Brazilian dances, and this also collaborates for an understanding of our urban cultures. So the art workshops that I already mentioned that we do during the morning when they are with hangover, and also with kids and families, and it's very interesting to see that families are not, like, they don't have prejudice to work with young that you can see that's in hangover, and you know the diversity of people that are gathering together. We just, like, people just started to feel more comfortable and more safe, and even the young's more safe, like free and open for everyone who feels interested can experience a language of fine arts. And the dialogue and trainings of the youngs. So this is written here in Portuguese, like, speak is silver, hear is gold. So we just bring like themes and subjects that are interested to them. So for instance, LGBT culture, social medias, feminism, and for instance, the genocide of the black young population that happens a lot in Brazil, and they are like victims of it. So it's a place that I see like an open school, like just an antique.
Como falaria uma praça da Grécia? Uma praça antiga da Grécia.
Uma praça da Grécia?
É. De fala, assim, de encontro, sabe? Tipo Sócrates.
Oi?
Tipo Sócrates, assim, os filósofos falavam e discutiam ideias para continuar a escrita.
Agora?
Agora. Yes, they're just these public spaces where people gather around to discuss some ideas and to build. And then I come again with this. Okay, so our open space for talks, debates, and meetings on themes that are linked to identity, culture, health prevention, gender, human rights, are among others. These are pressing issues in the day today of young people. So then, so for instance, we bring those drag queens and people that are researching like the LGBT identity for them who are as well LGBT but not accepted and not with like so much repertoire to stand for themselves so they can talk to each other and be like stronger and come together with this idea of accessibility of the museum that's to think, wish, and build the reality everybody wants to live. That's it.
Что особенно удивительно, да, что, ну, например, в России такое было бы критически невозможно, потому что если бы, представьте себе, музейным образованием занимались бы трансвеститы, понятно бы, того, кто это организовал, сразу бы арестовали.
Was in the Russian museums, this person would be arrested. You know, I did a project with MERMM. I know that they are thousands and thousands of different young people who gather in this park that include transgenders, for example, and LGBT people. They just realized that that's their identity, and they also come to this park. They may have an orgy by the evening, so basically they live in this park, and the museum also works with this. Yeah, just try to understand that museum didn't come up with this party, the party just exists there.
Like 6 years, and we were working for 3 years.
And museum is what, how old, like 50, 60 years, right?
Yeah, the museum have this space like 30 years, yeah, but already 70 years.
Музею 70, соответственно, вечеринка пришла в музей, который
Yeah, so the party came to the museum and said, I exist here, I exist around you. And, nothing could be done, because that was reality around the museum.
Кто меня встретил? На ресепшене меня встретил человек с синдромом Дауна.
When I came to the museum for the first time, the person who met me had Down syndrome, and he wished me to enjoy the exhibition. That actually shocked me. I've never seen anything like that before. Or on another occasion, I saw a transgender drag queen who was showing some of the exhibits to a deaf person in sign language. That was something unthinkable. And Dana also told me that they also hired a homeless person who was sleeping near the museum. He had a good education, he was just lost in his life. And what they did, they hired him and adapted him. Now he's working for the museum and he's back to like full life. I think that's what's great, is that this museum is very open to the environment around it. It's very open to the people around it, and I really envy you. If you have any questions, please raise your hands.
I have a question. We know that Brazilian history in the 20th century was quite hard and sometimes even tragic.
You didn't have any basically democracy, and these projects you are talking about would have been unthinkable like 50 years ago when you had a totally different regime. What we hear from the news is that the political climate in Brazil is also changing, like your president changed lately. So here is my question.
Does the museum have to participate in this social debate about the possibility of such programs? Do you experience any attacks, any violence from the more conservative people, conservative communities? For example, as for our museum, it was attacked by Orthodox activists. Thought our programs were unacceptable. What's your experience?
Okay, yes, thank you for the question. We are just like in Brazil, we are starting to get without democracy again. So yeah, so we are not sure until when we are going to be able to talk about everything. We just keep talking, and we never, since now, we never get like a huge ameaça, Fyodor. Ameaça. No, it's like people that conservative that fight against us. What happens is like, for instance, when we are talking about like transgender or with the drag queens or whatever, and some people go and they're like, oh, you're viado, I don't know how to say it, like,
but faggot.
Yeah, so, but we have to talk a lot with, like, with the people, with our, the people that are making this dialogue, is that what, so we can talk with our, like, partners or people that believes in diversity and believes that everyone can be as they want, but what, and getting back to the question, what changes the city is when we are able to talk to a conservative and maybe change his mind. So there's a lot of work that we do to like a real language, a real communication would be between two persons that doesn't speak the same language. Okay, so people that, a guy that thinks that a gay must die, he can change them, change his mind hearing this dialogue, and this is what we want and what we aim. And about like, okay, so about like, we try to do like, for instance, so there was this conservative that they just painted in gray color a huge mural about Gilberto Gil. I don't know if you know who is Gilberto Gil. It's a great musician of Brazil that he used to be the Ministry of Culture about the old government, and he's just amazing. His ideas were so progressive and was a period about like very, very special period from the diversity culture from all over the country. So what we did, as they painted the wall, this big mural with his image, we just do a big concert in the whole park in homenageando. In a tribute for him. So until now, the museum can do these things, but I hope we don't get back to the 60s and 70s, but we are in a way that's very like scary and dangerous in Brazil.
В 60-70-е там была диктатура военная. А, Бразилия помнит. Да, пожалуйста,
this Brazil faced military dictatorship. Final question. Анна, большое спасибо за вашу презентацию. Я пару лет назад была в вашем музее, и для меня...
It was one of the first places on my top list to do in the city. And that's why I have a question. Do you have some plans to grow? Because your role and the role of the museum is very important in the city, and it was just the first feeling when I came to São Paulo. And it's again the question about the role of the government. Do they, I don't know, maybe some other institutions, do they plan to support you? Do you plan to grow, to get a new building in the other parts of the city? Because just to have only one museum in a very popular big park, I think it's really not enough for the big city like São Paulo. Thank you.
Well, I work in museum it's been 15 years, and I can say like 10 years that I worked there. Our dream, like the dream of the whole staff, was to get a bigger building and to grow. But nowadays, like curiously, it's not a dream, not our dream anymore. Like we want, like I think we understood another kind of growing. That's growing, is learning with the society and the community and really becoming part. So there was this big research that they made about the habits of the Paulistano, of people who live in São Paulo. What do they do? What do they frequent, like cultural spaces? And what do they remind of each museum that they've been to? So if they go to Pinacoteca, they remind of the building. If they go to MASP, they remind of the building as well, and then the demonstrations. And if they go to Hmong, people remind of people and doing artistic activities. So this was really special for us, because the people, like the population, and it was a huge research, they don't remind like about building and exhibition, but they remind what they've done there. So it's kind of like, and the crisis and the financial crisis is getting so big that we see our colleagues of other museums having to quit people from the, so our plan nowadays is not to build in, to grow in this way, like a big building and big costs and everything, because we don't know what's going to happen. But it's a pleasure to see growing like this, like people from all these 10,000 youngs and kids are all together with us. We see as a way of growing. And today, the City Hall, they are also doing activities. So they saw with us that it started to work, and they started to do activities in other places of the park with us like advising them. So it is as well another way to grow, like to share experiences and other places start to do.
Спасибо большое, Даня. Спасибо вам. И мы двигаемся к нашей заключительной теме сегодняшнего разговора. Это тема очень важная. Это тема центробежной силы, музея, который влечет за собой толпы, тектонические разломы, провоцирует перемещение на городской карте. И первый человек, который об этом немного нам расскажет сегодня, это будет Катя Бочавар, которая руководит проектом GRUND.
GRUND,
как мы уже поняли, находится на улице Ирины Левченко, запомним название.
We have already discussed that it also
есть два помещения, оба находятся в городских жилых домах, причем в одном случае это вообще пятиэтажка. Вот, поэтому Катя, когда там
GRUND centers, there are two of them, they are located in residential blocks.
И вот же интересно узнать, как у тебя получилось сделать так, что многие из нас, на далекий Сокол и Октябрьское поле,
visit your exhibitions, which are very far from the Moscow city center. Примерным
искусством, которое ты там показываешь.
Ну, раз. Алло. Вот. Ну, первое, что я хочу вам сказать,
the first thing
я вам
I want to tell you, I congratulate you with today's
Citaday.
I'm really amazed with your heroic deed. I would say, because I'm totally freezing and I'm surprised that you are still with us. I would have left, I think. So I will be brief. As for the GRUND project, I would call it an exhibition space. I don't think it's a museum, and I think it does change the reality. I spent a lot of years living in Moscow. I did a project in the Red October Exhibition Center. We visited the first exhibition space on the territory of this plant. It smelled of sugar steel, because it was still functioning basically as a chocolate factory. The project was called Babakov Art Project. I came to this project as an artist, and I became an architect of the exhibition spaces, and now in all the CVs I'm officially called an architect. I'm not an architect at all. This project lived here for 2 years, and then it was driven away from here when new restaurants were opened, which had more money, basically. It's what we call gentrification. But thanks to this so-called gentrification, a lot of changes happened in my life. The project was actually huge, 4,000 square meters.
Средняя посещаемость этого этих выставок была 8 человек.
We had quite few visitors, just 8 visitors per day. You know, for 4,000 square meters and a few million dollars put into every exhibition. Then I was very young and still a true artist, and I thought like people should not even come, you know, and spoil everything, touch everything. What I wanted to do was to create a special atmosphere. But my worldview changed a lot.
Olga Sviblova
came to the first one of these exhibitions, and she asked me to be the architect of the Giardini Hall. It later helped me a lot. People learned about me, and I was invited to curate the project, rather two projects, two galleries, which were created out of living quarters in some residential areas. Maybe you know that, like in the 90s and before, every Moscow district had to have a so-called culture house, like a community center and a museum. All of these, in the 90s and later, in the 21st century, these community centers were not used anymore. And we used these exhibition halls of the community center, which were misused, and I started to create these spaces. This was a lot about decentralizing art, you know, about moving away from the city center. For me, it was quite a shock because normally I stayed inside of the Sotheby ring in the very heart of Moscow, and I really hate leaving the city center. We have been discussing it for a while today. What changes the city? I think the city is changed by the passion of people who do something. For example, Naila, who spoke about the PERMM experience, I think is one of the most passionate curators. It's a great pleasure for me that my works were also exhibited in the museum she's working in. So when I took up this project, not only me, but also other people from the team, it was created in 2014, not so long time ago, just 3 years ago, basically.
Дело в том, что когда мы взялись за этот проект, мы совершенно не понимали,
when we took up this project, we didn't realize what we would work with. None of us had ever worked with, you know, local communities from the suburbs, basically. Most of the museums are located in the city center, and they have their own audience, their specific visitors. So first, when I moved to this faraway places, I started to realize how important it is to invite people to our exhibition halls. I really envy, for example, Naila at the PERMM Museum had 2,000 people for the museum night. I think now I think that it's really important to invite people to your world.
В городе приходит 2,500 человек в Перми
Just try to imagine it. In PERMM, which is quite a small town, 2,500 people come to quite a complicated exhibition overnight. That's just unimaginable, I think. That's just because of her passion. The pictures you can see on the screen are just photos of our exhibitions throughout 3 years. So what's our experience? What did we learn in this 3 years? How did we start working with the audience? We worked not only with the residents of these districts, but also we tried to change the perspective of the artists we work with. So our suggestion for the artists was to turn their face to the audience. You know, we wanted the artists to be eager to talk to the public, not just to share their personal situation or something. They wanted to be heard. So we used lots of tricks. GRUND never works with fine arts.
В чистом виде мы занимаемся кросс-дисциплинарными
проектами, cross-disciplinary
projects.
So we unite different trends of culture, and we are striving the contemporary art to become a communicative, a new language, basically, a new way of communication.
Мы интересуемся, из чего же состоит этот язык.
So,
поэтому наши
we are trying to understand what this language consists of. All of our exhibitions are focused on what is interesting for our audience. Tomorrow we are launching a new exhibition, Grounding, which has the same name every year. You know, the title of our gallery is also Ground, and our label looks like the symbol of grounding. For us, a grounding is the way of engaging the local public. Tomorrow, we are going to present over 20 collectors who collect very different things, bottles, you know, pieces of fabric, wood, very different things. We are trying to turn every one of our exhibitions into a total installation. This is what I'm interested in personally. So we don't want our exhibitions to, you know, remind the iconic contemporary art. On the contrary, we are introducing our audience to the history. We are asking our audience to join us into the future. We tell them about our projects and about the artists
who are cutting edge
in contemporary dance, sound arts,
всех видов искусства.
And
для того,
all types of arts.
Обжить эту территорию, а мы действительно находимся на первых этажах.
We live on the ground floor of residential houses, which are quite far from metro stations. It's very hard to find us, and I always say that our visitors are my personal heroes, because I would never have, you know, found us. I would never have put so much effort in finding us. We are quite poor. We have a very low budget. The maximum budget we have is 60,000 rubles for an exhibition. So we use different kinds of help from the community which was formed around us. We are true trash collectors. We collect trash from all around. We are turning to different museums and we are asking them to bring us something. Anything they are throwing away, we're asking them to bring to us, like glass, podiums, anything. I could give you, you know, guided tour, tell you about every chair or every table in our gallery, tell you where we got them from. People like us, they tend to like us. Yesterday, Facebook showed me the dynamics of our Facebook page last year, last week, but what was most interesting for me was not the dynamics of likes, but
еще несколько музеев и GRUND, понимаете?
It was rather the fact that they saw on one and the same page on Facebook such institutions as Garage and other ones which have huge budgets and our galleries, GRUND, which are quite poor and which have tiny budgets. That means that what we do works. We print our own magazines, we distribute them ourselves.
So, what
do we do? Actually, we do the same things as other museums. Museums attract people, not only with their exhibitions. Of course, exhibitions are cool, but it's not the most important thing that happens in our walls. We create festivals. We had the first Samizdat self-publishing festival, for example. We also invite different residents. And we have the first in Russia sound art studio. We have a theater which have existed for over 3 years.
When
we created GRUND as a space, my dream was to gather different people under our roof so that they would work with each other and create common projects. And this is what happened. Just imagine that. And we are really proud that the products that we produce, exhibitions, festivals, they are all working for this community. By the way, the exhibition we are starting tomorrow is our 49th exhibition in just 3 years. That's a lot. We hosted over 400 concerts and over 200 events. We had lots of workshops, dance performances, and so on and so forth. Please come to visit us. Over 200 lectures. What am I driving at? I'm just trying to say that love and passion and the desire to work, the desire to turn not only your life into art, but also the desire
что аудитория вокруг тебя не тупа.
To engage your audience is crucial. You have to believe that your audience is not stupid. You know, if your neighbors come to you from the residential blocks, you have to talk to him, you know, offer him a hot tea, and then this person will return for the next exhibition. That's what matters. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Я лишь хочу сказать, что GRUND — это
абсолютные
невероятные споры, которые были грамотно
позиции.
Нет, мы знаем и о других проектах на окраинах Москвы. Есть электробутик, который сделали
GRUND is one of the few examples of projects that survive in distant, you know, districts of Moscow. You know, I apologize that I normally don't visit such galleries, such projects. I went to GRUND only three times, but what I saw there is just fantastic. It's worth going there, you know, it's worth the metro trip. It's not that far.
Но мы сегодня, если у кого-то возникли вопросы, я готов.
If anyone has any questions.
Простите, пожалуйста, у меня не вопрос. Я просто
I don't have a question. I will just try to speak the unspeakable. I wanted to say a real thank you to Katya and to Naila, because I visited the PERMM Museum with Sasha Frolov.
Это просто что-то невероятное.
And I saw the exhibition there. It was something unimaginable. Thank you very much for existing, you know, for being here, for giving us this impulse. I don't know where you get all the energy from and all the force, you know. You and the jet laggers, you're just brilliant, guys. Thank you very much.
Но сейчас мы поговорим о новостях. Мы говорили о микромире искусства, а теперь поговорим о макро, потому что год назад у всех в музейном мире сердце ушло в пятки, когда стало известно, что многолетний, восьмилетний, девятилетний, я уж теперь не знаю, директор
Everybody was surprised that Eric
Shiner
decided to leave Warhol Museum in Pittsburgh after 10 years of working there.
потому что именно такого человека ему не хватало, этому коварному, капиталистически скроенному организму.
Вот, и аукционный дом Sotheby
приобрел руководителя своего современного искусства в лице этого блистательного человека, между прочим, япониста, который очень много знает о Японии. Сегодня он немного поговорит об этом. Кстати, вы должны знать, что завтра в 16.00 состоится лекция Дайны Риттен, на которой она подробно расскажет о образовательной программе и о всех удивительных приемах музея Мам Сан-Паула. А в 14.00 Эрик Шайнер расскажет вам о своих секретах и мистериях. Вот, но это все будет завтра. А сейчас он в течение 15 минут немного расскажет нам о том, как же за те 8 лет, что он работал директором музея Warhol, который кончились всего год назад, он сумел изменить облик и настроение своего родного Питтсбурга, в котором он родился, в котором вырос, из которого довольно быстро уехал и в который вернулся уже в роли директора главной достопримечательности этого города. Make some noise! Он последний!
Make some noise. Well, hello, Moscow. It is fantastic to finally be here. Fyodor, thank you for bringing me, and to Strelka for inviting me as well. I've dreamt for many, many years about visiting Moscow, and I'm thrilled to be here this evening to talk about consumption times production. I think that museums, more than any other sites in our society, are places where we consume culture and where culture is produced. And what I'm going to do tonight may seem a little bit strange, but it's going to be a tale of two cities, Pittsburgh and New York, through the lens of an artist that we all know named Andy Warhol, who you see here on the screen before us. Andy, of course, was born in 1928 in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the children of immigrants from Slovakia. So he had Eastern European roots. He grew up speaking Rusyn with his mother, Julia, and his father, Andrei. And he faced so many challenges as a young man. His family was poor. He was sickly. He had many neurological conditions that kept him home from school for over 2 years. He was gay, as a closeted gay kid, not being able to fully express himself and be who he wanted to be. So the man that you see would, of course, later, we know, go on to become one of the most famous people the world has ever known. And yet he came, you were talking earlier about provincialism, and to say that Pittsburgh in the 1930s and 1940s was provincial is a vast understatement. So, flash forwarding to the 1940s into the 1950s, this is a photograph of Andy in New York City in 1949, the year that he graduated from college. Andy, of course, we know, was incredibly talented from a very early age. His mother, Julia, happened to be an artist, and she happened to teach him how to draw. He also happened to have a love of art, a love of art museums. It's important here to note that Pittsburgh, his hometown, as provincial as it was, also happened to be an incredibly wealthy place in the early part of the 20th century. It was the site of industrial production with steel and tin and bronze and aluminum and the things that literally built America and ultimately the American economy. As such, it had really fantastic museums, especially the Carnegie Museum of Art, where Andy, as a young child, would take art classes and absorb art, learn about it, sketch, and he honed his skills to the point that he was able to go to Carnegie Tech, which is today Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh, where he studied commercial illustration. He did quite well, graduating in 1949 and going straight to New York City, realizing that he could not become a famous artist, his dream, something that he wanted more than anything, to be world famous and world very well known. So he embarks to New York City in 1949. Here he is standing with his friend Philip Perlstein and another friend, all graduates of college. And he starts to, in so many ways, absorb everything about New York, the great cultural capital of the world, its cafes like Serendipity 3, which is still open today, who ultimately would give Andy Warhol his first show, hanging his shoe drawings and other commercial illustrations on the walls of the cafe, allowing him to present his work to the public. I could, of course, talk tonight for five hours at least about Andy Warhol. I have 15 minutes. And of course, Warhol is connected to 15 minutes, saying that in the future, everyone would be world famous for 15 minutes. But his interactions with New York were huge. And in so many ways, just as he absorbed and consumed the culture of New York, very quickly, he started to produce the culture of New York. And in 1962, when he presented his Campbell's soup cans, the work that would make him world famous, and almost overnight, he did so in Los Angeles, not in New York. But he very quickly had exhibition after exhibition in New York City, including this image at the 1964 World's Fair that was held in a huge park, Corona Park, in Queens, in New York City, where Andy decided to hang on the facade of the New York State Pavilion, the host state, images of the 13 most wanted criminals in New York City from just a few years before. A huge mural, 20 feet by 20 feet. It wasn't a great idea to welcome the world to New York, showing felons, criminals. So this was very quickly painted out, covered with silver paint, and yet it stands as a legendary artwork in New York City. Another work that Andy literally turned the camera on New York was his film Empire, which is one of the most important avant-garde films made in New York and in America ever. It's an over 8 hour long film of the Empire State Building. Andy wanted to make the most boring film ever made. He wanted the audience to fall asleep by filming a static building for over 8 hours. Nothing happens except going from daytime to nighttime and the lights turn on. That's the big aha moment in this film. But he's putting his artwork into the city just as he's using the city as his subject. Here you have a picture of Andy with Edie Sedgwick, one of his muses, and his studio assistant Gerard Malanga in the background, quite literally coming up from the sewers of New York for a posed photograph. But through his connection to New York, his artwork featuring New York, like the Statue of Liberty here in this great 3D painting from 1962, later to his nightlife, his connection with the entertainment culture of New York, most specifically at Studio 54, which was the most famous nightclub in New York that Andy would go and have fun every night with celebrities like Liza Minnelli there in the red dress. Ultimately painting the VI drink tickets for Studio 54. What I'm saying is Warhol was becoming completely fully integrated into the culture of New York and in so many ways representing the culture of New York. And sadly, Andy died incredibly young at the age of 58 after complications for a very routine gallbladder surgery. So all of a sudden, the Prince of Pop, the King of Pop Art, dies, and New York doesn't quite know what to do, simply because by this point in his life, Andy Warhol equals New York. And it's always fascinated me so much to think that a kid from Pittsburgh, a poor kid from an immigrant family, was able to, in so many ways, define American culture in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s. Through his artwork, so much so that there was even a monument to Andy called the Andy Monument, made by a contemporary artist named Rob Pruitt, that was only supposed to be situated in New York City in Union Square for just a few months. But people loved it so much that it stayed for nearly 2 years, and the city is still trying to figure out how to bring it back so that it's there permanently. Simply because Andy and New York are so integral. This is a side picture I wanted to put in of the great political artist from China, Ai Weiwei, standing at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art in New York, in front of Andy's self-portraits, mimicking the same gesture. And of course, today, Ai Weiwei is one of the most important artists working in the world today. Interestingly, went to New York because he knew Andy Warhol was there. He wanted to be in the sphere of Andy Warhol, the aura of Andy Warhol, and ultimately has now gone on to, in his own way, change the face of contemporary China through his artwork and his political action. Now, how do you take all of these many things of Andy Warhol, who's authored in so many ways the hip, cool nature of New York, how do you bring that back to his hometown of Pittsburgh, that provincial place that he comes back to, not in life, but in death? And how do you create an institution that honors him, celebrates him, but keeps him alive, so that it never becomes a mausoleum, but it becomes an active zone? This is the facade of the Warhol Museum in Pittsburgh. It's in a beautiful 1911 building. It's absolutely stunning. And when I became first the curator of the museum and then the director, I wanted literally Warhol to spill out onto the streets. So I installed his cow wallpaper in the front windows and put video monitors out to beam him out. But I also put speakers outside so that we could beam disco music from Studio 54 out to the street. And even in our parking lot, we created, instead of just a boring industrial booth for our parking attendant to sit in, I made it into a huge Brillo box. So that right from the beginning, when you visit the museum, you realize that you're having a true Warholian experience. And I want to thank all of the panelists tonight for all of the amazing work that they do about diversity and inclusion and making sure people feel at home in a museum, because I think that's what museums stand for. That's what they are. They're safe places where dialogue can happen and where people can be themselves and be creative and think outside of the box. And certainly Andy Warhol did that more than probably anyone. So this is the interior of the museum. We did a full renovation for our 20th anniversary in 2014. I was very lucky when I was just coming out of college to be an intern at the Warhol Museum when we opened in 1994. So I was there at the very beginning and was also there, luckily, to celebrate our 20th anniversary. And as you can see, we created a lobby that was very reflective of Andy and his time, mimicking his silver factory, which was his studio workshop. So all of the walls are covered with what looks like silver bricks. We replicated the sofa that Andy had in his factory there on the left so that our visitors could sit on the sofa and mimic Andy in the photograph above. And of course, at the very back, you see Andy holding up his most famous image, that of Marilyn Monroe. But in addition to just making Warholian environments, we also carried through with what Warhol would want and what Warhol would think about, making sure that diversity and inclusion were the most important things. So I always would say that Andy Warhol was probably the biggest anomaly possible. Poor, gay, challenged, having medical issues, he was a complete anomaly of society. However, going on to become the most famous person in the world, really, he becomes the ultimate paradigm. He becomes that which we compare all else in contemporary art to. So I wanted to carry that on in the work that we did at the museum, and also, and maybe even more importantly, make sure that the museum was a place that we could give voice to people that don't always have voice. So how people could come to the museum through our education programs, our exhibitions, and anything else at the museum. For example, we would host the annual queer or gay and lesbian prom for teenagers in Pittsburgh so that they had a safe space, somewhere they could go and just be themselves and be free. And we knew that that's what Andy would have wanted, always making sure that the underdog was celebrated. And that's how we always move forward in our exhibition program and all else that we did. And just should any of you happen to visit Pittsburgh, make sure you visit his grave site, which has become a complete shrine, a place that people visit, leave notes, leave soup cans, and you can see the Orthodox cross there on the grave. as well. It's interesting to note that Andy wanted his gravestone to say only one word. He wanted that word to be figment, as though he was a figment of our imagination, as though he may never have existed. However, his family decided to do a very traditional gravestone, as you see here. So that's what I have to say tonight, that museums, by the way, I should say that I respectfully disagree with Olga, who says that museums don't change places. I really think they do. And I think that they're, again, a site of consumption and production that make us as people change our mindsets and change the way we think. And knowing certainly how Pittsburgh used to be that provincial place, that conservative place, I can safely tell you today that Pittsburgh is a completely open-minded and liberal city where even the taxi drivers tell people they have to go and visit the Warhol Museum. Very different from the case when we opened now 23 years ago today.
Thank you so much, Eric. And maybe someone has any, like a quick question, because we're very late and it's time for us to go and sleep or party or else. Друзья, если у кого-то есть вопросы, пожалуйста, это может быть заключительный вопрос сегодняшнего вечера.
Okay, let it be the final question for tonight.
Okay, hello. My question is very stupid and it doesn't cover the theme of our discussion, but if you could meet Andy Warhol, what would you ask him?
Oh, wow, that's not a stupid question at all. There's no such thing as a stupid question. Well, I've been asked so many times in my life if I ever did meet Andy Warhol, and I never did. So I was in high school when he died. I was a first year student in high school. Andy died in 1987. But I knew him somehow through MTV and through mass media. And as I became a scholar of Warhol, working at the museum and studying about him in graduate school and those sorts of things, I felt as though I really got to know him intimately. And I was always very honored when Andy's best friends would tell me, wow, Andy would have loved you. He just would absolutely adore you. But in answer to your question, what would I ask him? I think it would just have to be something very, very basic. Asking him if he was happy about what he accomplished in his lifetime. And in so many ways, he changed the very nature of contemporary art. He changed the very nature of aesthetics. And ultimately, became the representative American artist in the latter half of the 20th century. I think the answer to that question would be yes, that he was happy with what he accomplished. But it would have to be something very basic like that.
Спасибо большое. Я думаю, все немного замерзли, все немного устали, но спасибо вам большое, вы были чудесными супергероями, слушателями и собеседниками. А если вы не будете против, то мы продолжим завтра в 14:00 лекция Эрика, в 16:00 лекция Дайны, и, наконец, в 17:00 я очень всех жду на разговор о том, как перформанс влияет на город, как влияет на его карту, как влияет на его памятник, как влияет на его судьбу и его тектонический разлом. Будем видеться завтра. Доброй ночи.
See you tomorrow. Good night.